Hey everyone, and welcome to our Connections webinar for Black History Month. And I'm excited to have our special guest. But before I introduce Renee Wilson, just remember this is a discussion and we would love to have your questions and comments throughout this. So with that, you guys all know how to do it. You've done it plenty of times before. I'm Eric Berman. I am the Director of Industry Relations Marketing here at Realtor.com. And I'm excited to have Renee Wilson, who is the CEO of the National Association of Real Estate Brokers, here with us today. And so very lucky. Hello, Renee. Thank you for joining us.
Sure. Good morning. Good morning. Thank you for having me. See Renee Wilson, and I'll tell a little bit as to how I became the See Renee Wilson as opposed to my full name. But thank you so much for the opportunity. Thanks for the invitation to come and share about our organization. It's something that I totally enjoy doing. So thank you so much for that opportunity. So well, See Renee Wilson.
Yes. Thank you. Please. Yeah, I wanted to know. I was going to ask you, but I didn't. So because I don't know how people feel about that. So.
Absolutely, not a problem. And I love the fact that this is conversational. So that fits well within how I enjoy talking about the organization. So see Renee Wilson, the Executive Director of the National Association of Real Estate Brokers. I have been with the organization. I joined as a member. I was a real estate agent starting my career. I kept a part-time license for many, many years. I would say the year I got licensed, but then you'd be able to calculate my age. So I'm going to leave that part out of it. But I've been licensed for a very long time.
I never asked that question, just so you know.
It's okay. Because I wouldn't have given you the answer anyway.
That's fair.
So joined the organization. So I've been with NAREB for about 25 years. I have been in an official role. You start off by being voluntold, because if I get involved in anything, I want to be of service. So anything that I join, I'm gonna jump in with 2 feet and be, you know, raise hand, what can I do, what can I do and get involved. That is how I actually got here. So by being voluntold on a lot of different things that was going on, I started volunteering my time. And I'd like to say that someone saw the talent that I didn't even know that I had and started to pull me in to the organization. I was the relationship manager for 18 years, and I have been between interim and full-time the executive director for almost the last 18 months. And so very excited that has really increased the things that I do and what I get to focus on. But the overall goal is we are here to increase opportunities for Black America to be able to build wealth for their families, based on what fits with their lifestyle. That's it in a nutshell. And as everyone knows, our percentages are extremely low. So I have the fortune of being able to get up every single day and focus on what do we do as an organization and how I support the leadership team and the vision and the mission and the objectives of the organization, which we'll talk a little bit about the structure in the organization. So for me, being involved for now 20 years has given me a great opportunity to better understand the challenges that exist and have existed, as we know, for a very long time in Black America. So to be able to be a part of an organization that focuses on how do we eradicate some of these obstacles, particularly today. I mean, there are some opportunities. There's some work that's being done, like special purpose credit programs and things of that nature, that gives us an opportunity to get some traction with the work that we do. So I'm really excited about that. The things that I love about the organization that attracted me to the organization was its history. 1947, being raised in a small country town in Louisiana by my grandparents. My mom was in Los Angeles, but by my grandparents during the time, I'm almost about to tell my age again, during the time when I was a little girl, my grandmother worked on a plantation. We were not allowed to cross the railroad tracks and to walk to her work. We had to walk down the railroad track. Are there, you know, vivid memories I have of not understanding why kids at the house could do things that I could not do. It was just a very different thing, better understand it now. But then as a young woman, a young girl, an analyst, I didn't really understand why things were so different. Never felt that things were different with my family members. I was just well-loved, had a great environment. but things were very different. And I moved to Los Angeles a little bit. After, I would say, Rodney King and all those kinds of things. And so it started to heighten my awareness of the things that were going on in America, and that I was a little different from everyone else. And then I was a part of the first busing program in Los Angeles. And that was a real, real experience. And so that experience, which was really interesting, there was one busload of us that was sent out to Encino, out to the valley in Los Angeles. And it was mutual. We didn't want to be there, and the kids that was there didn't want us there. So that was an interesting phenomenon to be in a neighborhood where everyone looked like you, and then being put in an environment where people didn't look like you, and what those types of emotions brought, and how people treated each other, and just the lack of understanding of different cultures and things that you just had not, is the unknown of what you had not been exposed to. And I'll give one example of that. During PE, I had one individual ask in the summer if I was going to turn purple. And I was trying to figure out why things was falling off of their faces. So we both had like a different experience of like, what is this really all about? So I share that experience because I think the part of that as to what's going on helped me to better appreciate that there were differences. And having the opportunity with the organization to be able to talk with others who don't look like me. I've managed the relationships for NAREB for a very long, for 18 years, and having conversations with people who does not look like me that are in those positions, being able to communicate. So the reason that I like the fact that you're doing things like this, Eric, is because it gives us an opportunity to share about differences and how, if we have a common goal or a mutual goal, how we can work together to be able to make a difference for whichever community that we're serving at the time. And I think that that is extremely critical. And so I think some of those things through my upbringing and my experiences, even though tragic as a young person going from a small country town to Los Angeles and then being bused and taken out of my normal environment and had been, I told my daddy was forcing me, being forced to engage with people who didn't look like me. I think there are some things that I did learn from that experience that
I have two questions. And the first is what you're just talking about. Like, so I'm sure when you first went into Encino from where you were, and you talked about you didn't want to be there, they didn't want to have you there. Did that change over time? Were you accepted more, and did you accept them more? Did some of those barriers break down? I mean, I'm sure there's some people. No,
by the time, so middle school and high school, I would say by the time we got to high school, there was an understanding. I'm not going to say it changed much because, you know, we were in a school environment, so there was no, you know, interaction really. We didn't live near each other, so there was no come visit or hang out.
Right.
We had some parental comments, you know, at events of why are you interacting if you don't interact. Very, a lot of the discrimination that we talk about, you could feel it as a youngster. I probably couldn't describe it the way I could describe it now. But I would say by the time that I graduated, the feeling of not wanting to be there and just the tension and not communicating and not talking and not just being respectful of the other person changed. But you know, kids, we can be a little mean when we're young as kids, right. But it was better. I'll say it was better than when I first got there. But okay. We didn't walk away being best friends and hanging out and that type of stuff.
Yes, it does. So my second question is more talking about the organization, because you were a member and a real estate professional. How has it been coming from the practitioner side to then being on the association staff side, and how has that informed your understanding of your members and how you deal with them on a daily basis?
And I think for me it has made a huge difference, because in my communication, in this role, you deal with the members, and we have regionals, and you deal with leadership, and you deal with affiliates, and you deal with regional vice presidents, state president, local board presidents. But I think being on that side initially and being in the trenches and understanding, serving the community and putting people in homes. And I also did mortgages for a while, and just the qualification of getting people into homes. And now being working with the leadership and supporting the vision and the strategies of the organization, I do have a, you know, more of a personal experience when I'm talking to, regardless to whether it's leadership or membership, my process that I've gone through, I think helps me in the communication of whatever is going on and how I'm trying to help someone with what they've called for in my role, because I understand that I've been on that side and the process that I've gone through to ascend to this particular position. I think the communication that I have with people, it certainly helps tremendously. Managing the partnerships and understanding, building the business case for them to support the organization, I think that journey has also helped by being, you know, in the community, by being on the lending side, by being involved in the organization, being involved in the discussions, looking, having our State of Housing in Black America report come out every year, looking at the data that's saying the percentages are so low, and having conversations about what needs to be done. That experience of being in the community and sitting across the table from a family, it definitely comes into play in helping you to really understand on this side the types of programmings, you know, the programming that you need to develop, the initiatives that you need to have, how you show up in a community, I think becomes really, really important. That definitely helps.
Oh, great. So you did sort of talk about how you, so my first question was, how would you describe the National Association of Real Estate Brokers? And you sort of did that, but can we get into the history a little bit? Because to me, as someone who enjoys history, that this was really, you know, that sort of got me into it. Like I was really, really interested like about it. So can you talk, because I know 1947, but can you talk about the history, how it started, why it started? I think for this audience, it's good to know why it started. And then we'll get into the structure a little bit, because this is all stuff the audience will definitely get and appreciate for sure. And remember, people, give me your questions. I am looking at the question box. No questions yet.
So, of course, 1947. So we just celebrated our 75th year anniversary. Think of it as Blacks were not allowed. Just be in the back of the bus, stay in the back of the bus, stay in your place, you know. And Blacks were not allowed to be real estate professionals. We were not allowed to be realtors. And so the why is because, you know, we have Black folks who say, you say no, we say yes. And so a group of Blacks got together in Tampa, Florida, and formed the organization similar to what we do today. You know, we're here fighting and trying to eradicate and overcome obstacles that we feel are keeping Blacks from building wealth, owning a home, things of that nature, you know, looking at policy. So I would say then it was far more intense of how do they find a way to be in the real estate industry to provide services in that environment to other Blacks, where nothing was in place for that to happen. You couldn't get a license, you couldn't get insurance, really couldn't do anything. And so I think these were extremely brave. You know, it's like today we can decide to do something. There's all sorts of opportunities to do it. Then it was like forbidden. You weren't really allowed. You weren't really allowed to speak up. So for them to find a way to form this organization and get started, and then start to talk to other Blacks to get them involved, and then to start building chapters across the country. The first convening was the following year that they had their first conference in 1948 of the convening of members to really start laying out the strategy of how they were going to create their own real estate organization, which is what has happened over the last 75 years of what we've become. But I can only imagine it's like creating something from nothing, because there wasn't an infrastructure there. There wasn't a process there. It wasn't, okay, well, now you go take your tests and you do A, B, C, D, and then you start to grow your business. That was not available for them. So to be innovative, man, just the persistence of pursuing and staying, you know, keeping your foot on the pedal, just being more than hard-headed. Like, this is something that we're going to do and we're going to figure out because it's extremely important for this community, for the Black community. And it's grown from there. But I would say the earlier years until the 1970s, Blacks were not allowed to be realtors. And so the ways to not have access to MLS to serve a community, you've got to be extremely, we were talking about social networking, you have to be authentic, and you have to be committed, and you have to be involved in your community for people to know who you are and to trust you, and to trust you with this very large investment, one of the biggest investments that you'll make in your life. So to imagine that there was no MLS back in the day and how people were able to be successful. And we had some extremely successful Blacks who got involved in the organization during that time. I would say the 47s to the 1970s, which I can't even imagine. But it was those people whose shoulders that we stand on today that has left the pathway. Now, of course, we have a relationship. We have a partnership with NAR. Our members are called Realtists. If you are a Black real estate professional and a member of the National Association of Real Estate Brokers, you are referred to as a Realtist and not a Realtor. And that is extremely important. Around the early 1970s, we were able to start practicing being a real estate professional in the industry. Some would think it was much further back than that, but just as early as that, the level of discrimination for Blacks in the real estate industry was very prevalent. And, you know, today we're still addressing, I think there's been, particularly with George Floyd, there's been some things and certainly some progress made, but we still have some challenges that we have to overcome with Blacks being involved in the industry from on the lending and the real estate professional side. And so within the organization, we do have a diversity, equity, and inclusion pillar. And of course, we do have our policy positions and things that we're steadily addressing and fighting. We have very, very good relationships.
Yeah, I do want to ask you about some of those advocacy things later on. So thank you for bringing that up.
Mm-hmm. It's a part of it. It's all wrapped into one. So when you ask me about the organization, one, we are a big family, like a big, big family. And when people come to our conferences and to our event, and I always say you bring your authentic self, which that's very important to engage with the realtors, and you have a genuine concern to be involved, I think that is extremely, extremely important. But the organization is very, you know, serious about the work that we do for the Black community and understanding what their challenges are and being able to, you know, sit at the table and articulate that to folks that are in positions to impact policy and legislation that will make a difference on the back end for us to be able to serve this community where they're able to build wealth.
So we actually have a question, and I think it sort of fits at this point. It's from our friend Lee. He said, Ms. Wilson, has NAREB ever considered rebranding? History aside, real estate broker sounds vaguely broad and less inclusive to me. So, I mean, because I know from reading about NAREB, it's open to real estate practitioners, you know, brokers, agents, appraisers, inspectors, anyone who's tangentially, right, connected to real estate can join, right?
Absolutely. We do have 10 affiliates, and thank you so much for that question. What we have done, there's been discussion about that over the years. The way that we've addressed it recently is to add a tagline that references everyone is welcome, the inclusiveness of the organization. And we're now starting to brand that on all of our marketing to get the word out. That it's an organization of real estate professionals. And so that's been the way that we've addressed that particular question. That's the answer to your question. So yes, well, we have discussed.
Thank you, Lee, for asking the question. Appreciate it. All right. So you talked about why where did the term realtist come from? I know you talked about why, because you couldn't be a realtor, but where did the, because I know in your history you do touch on it, so I want you to explain it a little bit if you could.
Yes, well, I mean, for me, from what I know, it's, we know that we were not going to use the name realtor, and we wanted something, you know, similar. And so it's that small group of folks in the room doing the organizing that were creative, that came up with Realtists, that I think is, you know, similar, but knowing that we did not want to be defined or described or classified as a realtor, being that we were not allowed to be realtors, you know, for so many years.
Okay, so you said you have 10 affiliates. How can somebody join the association, and how do you join if you're not an affiliate, or if you are an affiliate? What is an affiliate? Let's start there.
So an affiliate, think of the affiliate groups as some of the areas of the real estate, other real estate disciplines. So we have property management, we have developers, we have housing counselors, we have a sales division to help agents and brokers with their sales. I talked about the developers. We have an appraisal, which, you know, is a really big topic right now. We also have an appraisal affiliate as well. So once you become a member of the organization through the new member orientation, we talk about these different avenues that if you are interested in learning a different trade, or if you've been in the industry for a while and been the agent and you've been the broker and you think that there's something else that you want to do, then we do certifications and designations within the organization. So you have an opportunity, if there is a different discipline that you think that you want to engage in, that you may have an interest in, you're able to, you know, to learn that trade within the organization by joining that particular affiliate and then learning about their certifications and designations and things of that nature. In San Diego, we're having our National Midwinter Conference next week. And on the front end of the conference, we're having the appraisal affiliate is doing a session in San Diego on how to become an appraiser. So our local chapter is reaching out to different community leaders and organizations that are serving millennials, students, and Gen Zs, and inviting them to come in to learn about how to become an appraiser. And then at the national, they'll be doing some certifications or designations for appraisers. So we'll have members who will be in that session, and we'll have young folks in the community and others who want to learn about that particular affiliate and seeing if they're interested. So things like that.
Do you have to be a licensee to join? I don't hold a license. I'm not a real estate practitioner, but could I join?
You can join as a, there are other different, so within the local market. So, and
you could you explain that?
Yeah.
Go into that.
So if you are a landscaper, or there's some other work that you do within the industry, and not just working that, if you're in a different field, you're not an agent or a licensed broker or something like that, you can join the local different, each chapter is different. So a local chapter, what you would ask about is, do they have an affiliate membership or some other classification of membership? But yes, there are, you can join under other classifications within a local market, and you do join by going to a local chapter. You don't join national. It's bottom up, not top down.
Right. Similar to the realtor organization. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And we do so have at large.
Lee has another question, but Lee, your question fits in later, so I'm going to put it on. I'm going to hold off on it right now. So it's, you join at a local level though, and then you become a member of the national. But there are only local chapters. There's not a state. It's just either local or national.
So the structure, we have national, we have regional, we have 12 regionals across the country. We have four states: California, Florida, Texas, and there's California, Texas, Florida, and Ohio. And in order to form a, there are some that are trying to pull it together, but in order to form a state, it's usually having, you know, four or five local chapters in your state to form a state. So right now we only have four.
Okay.
But we do have state.
Okay. So what are some, I want to talk about that a little bit, but again, that fits a little later. You meant, but what advocacy issues is the association focused on right now? And which ones do you, are you looking for, you know, so yes. What advocacy are you doing right now?
Yes.
I'll get it out.
You got it out. And I'm reading your mind. So of course, a big one for us is appraisal bias. I think that's become a really, really hot topic. When you can get the disparity that we're seeing between Black and white values in the same neighborhood, pretty much same house, whitewashing, that's become a major deal in getting the information out. So there's, you know, we have more eyes on appraisal bias and focus on how do we address the appraisal bias. So that is a top priority for us as well from a policy position. Loan level pricing, price adjustments. That's a big one for us because as we know for underserved communities, the more layering just really pushes people out of the opportunity of homeownership. So we see that as a challenge as well. So
what do you mean by layering?
So if you have a low credit score, if you have high debt close to the debt ratio, you get another. So by the time you add all these different percentages and
you have an extra high interest rate.
Exactly. You price people out of, you know, ownership. And we see that a lot in the Black community. Okay. And we do quite a bit of work. We've developed a play. I've done quite a bit of work with diversity, equity, inclusion, student loan debt. We know that there's been some adjustments that the secretary has done. We'd like to see, you know, we continue to talk about what else that we can do to help students. Of course, the Biden administration has been, you know, making some adjustments as well, but that's been something that we've had on our, you know, on our topics, you know, the topics that we focus on for advocacy, the advocacy work that we do. And of course, you know, addressing just increasing homeownership is really big for us. So our play has content that at a student level for HBCUs, it was built for HBCU students to educate them. We talk about student loan debt, and we talk about primarily homeownership and credit and things of that nature. And it also focuses quite a bit on minority participation in all aspects of the real estate and financial services industry, because we need more Blacks from C-suite to all of our affiliate disciplines. You pick a topic and there's a low percentage of African Americans in that particular line of work. So we do have a focus on that as well. We're looking at creating, launching our mentorship program so that NAREB becomes the one-stop shop. If you're looking for Black talent, we want you to be able to come to the organization and find an appraiser and find a mortgage person. And so we know that there's a lot of work we need to do there, but we think that we are the organization, you know, that should be working on that as well, contributing to addressing.
So with that in mind, so where do you see NAREB in the next 5, 10 or more years?
I'm so happy that you asked me that question. We have had absolutely incredible growth over the last couple of years. I think the work that we've done, just like a lot of them, sometimes you don't think that things are happening. You're working, and you just don't see the results of the goals that you set. Rolling into our 75th anniversary, you know, we had more chapters chartered. We've got more inquiries about starting chapters, a lot more media coverage, a lot more invitations to share, New York Times and things of that nature. So this has been an incredible year. So if I take samplings from this year and I multiply that by 5 or 10 years, I think our impact more than anything in the Black community is going to be felt, if you will. I think that as we focus more and sharpen our strategies and our programming, leveraging our State of Housing and Black America report and following the data on where the real needs are, and then building and creating and strategizing and building programming to address those needs, I believe if you are solving for a need, you can't have anything but success. And so that's a lot of the work that we are, you know, we're doing. The leadership spends a lot of time with our SHEBA report looking at what we're doing. As we know, the rubber meets the road in a local market. So we're connecting national to local and trying to be, we are one NAREB with our regions and state and locals and our affiliates. We have 34 committees. We've got a lot of wonderful people who volunteer their time that are engaged, that's getting a lot of voluntold, that loves this organization and is very involved in their community. So I think as we continue to grow, our Realtors family is, like I said, a true family. So I think as we continue to bring more people in and they get acclimated to the culture of who we are and what we do and really buy into that and bring their resources and their passion to the table, we're just going to be extraordinary in the way of an organization. And I think our impact in communities and the increase in percentages of home ownership, the things that we have as goals, we'll start to be able to make an impact on. That's my heart's desire for where I feel that we're going, and I look forward to seeing and being a part of. Of course, some of it, you know, 20 years from now, I'll be sitting on a beach, maybe looking at social media.
I hope so. I hope that works out.
No, Eric, this was gonna happen 20 years ago.
Yeah, no, I'll say, hey, Renee, remember when you said you'd be on a beach?
You said that?
Yeah.
Yes.
So now I'm gonna go back to Lee's question because it's the same question that I had, and so, especially with this audience, what can MLS and realtor associations do to help promote NAREB and its mission? How can be part of this big family of, you know, real estate practitioners, and how do we do that? How do we help promote? How do we help your association and meet its mission? And
absolutely. So I think it starts with the Realtor.com relationship and managing partner relationships. I think when we create a close partnership that Realtor.com truly understands the organization's goals and what objectives and what we're trying to do and how we implement our programming and what we have, what we're offering national down to the local markets and get engaged. I think then you are able to share with your network the work that we're doing, where we're doing the work. The thing that I constantly share and say is being authentic, just being your authentic self and getting involved and showing up and understanding what it is we're doing and what we're trying to do and wanting to be a part of what's been created and the infrastructure that we have. I think that we can do that well. We have quite a few partners. And as we build a relationship with the partners can share with their network, and the network shares, and more people share, the more that we get the word out. It's important to get the word out. But getting the right word out is also important, which I think comes from really understanding who we are and what we do.
So can two things. One, can a local association partner with a local chapter? Can a local realtor association or an MLS partner with a local NAREB chapter to promote events? Can a member of NAREB come and speak at a local realtor association event or any event an MLS might have? Is that something that you encourage or you're trying to look for? Those types of relationships?
Of course, we do have a partnership with the National Association of Realtors, and we talk about, you know, our local chapters working together. Both our organizations, our local chapters have their own autonomy. So we can suggest and we can, you know, share what is, you know, goodwill in a market, but it is really up to the local market and who's in the market. I know that there are some chapters that have a great relationship that are working together. And what we started talking about, when life can be different because people are different, there are unfortunately some markets today where the local chapters don't choose not to communicate and engage.
Well, how can we overcome that? How can we overcome that? What's a good way to continue to build that bridge?
I think it comes with, and that's why I go back to showing up as your authentic self, getting involved in the local chapter, getting to know the leadership and having the conversation. making the recommendation, being a part of the team, saying, you know, here's an idea, what do you think about this? But I think, you know, showing up as your authentic self, where people know that you're very passionate and you're very sincere, that's where the work really is. And getting past that, I think then opens up the doors to other opportunities. Getting to know the people in that market, understanding what that local chapter is trying to accomplish, learning who the leadership team is, what that looks like, and then finding your place within that local chapter and getting involved. But it starts with, to me, being your authentic self when you show up, and it's relationship building. As we all know, relationships is the key to a lot of things. And so making a priority of relationship building, and then the communication follows of what's possible, because it is market by market. So it's very difficult to say, this is what we need to do on a national scale, because when it gets to the local market, you've got to build the relationship. You've got to learn the culture of the organization. You've got to understand the objectives of the organization. You've got to understand the structure and see if that fits with you to be involved. But certainly we're an organization that's open to everyone. We don't discriminate.
Of course. Could a local realtor association help Black members establish a NAREB chapter, or can a local realtor association help with that in any way? Because I'm just wondering, I know there's not chapters everywhere. So if there was enough critical mass of folks who wanted to start one, you know, is there a role for a realtor association to help facilitate that? Because, you know, looking at, you know, based on the audience who's on with us today, just want to give them some tips to maybe help facilitate if they see a need for some of their members.
So I would say if you're in a market and you have a large percentage of African Americans, and you have a large percentage of African American consumers, and you think that that is a great place to start a NAREB Realtors chapter to serve the Black community, the regional vice president that we have, that's part of their responsibility in growing chapters. So I would say start the communication if there's not a chapter in your market, and if you do have a large percentage of African Americans and you have a large percentage of Blacks in the real estate industry, that you can start a conversation with a regional vice president to see if in fact this is, you know, the process that it takes to start a chapter, if you have all of the criteria to start a chapter, because according to the bylaws, there are some criteria that you have to meet in order to start.
Yes.
A chapter. So I would say start there with, you know, the Black population. What do you have? What does that look like? And then identifying, and it's on the website, identifying where there is a president, then having the conversation with them to talk about the rest of the criteria and what you see, but be educated on why you want to start a chapter and make sure that you're really understanding what we offer to a community as an organization, and that it's aligning with our objectives and our mission is extremely important.
No, that's a good point. Thank you.
And you can always call me and have a conversation. I'm a little direct at times, but you're welcome to give me a call if you'd like, and I can screen you and make sure you're on the right track.
In the nicest possible way.
I'm not always very nice, but you can take your chances. No, not really. You can certainly call me. But I am a little direct at times.
Well, you've been very nice to me, so thank you very much for taking it easy on me. Does anybody have any other questions? Let's see, because Lee has one. It doesn't make sense, Lee, so you need to put it back in there in a way that I can see it in the box. You know, one good thing I was wondering, like, just in terms, you know, you talk about lending, and I know, because prior to my life in the realtor world, I worked for in affordable housing. And I know, you know, predatory lending and subprime lending hit everybody hard, hit minority communities hardest. And I just wonder, and I know there's been changes in lending now, but I'm just like, how, just generally speaking, how has the community recovered from that, and what changes do you need to see to be make it even more equitable? Because I obviously have an interest in that, and if nobody's going to ask her the question, any more questions, I'm going to ask that.
Ooh, of course, it had major impact on right. Black community. Some folks today probably still haven't recovered. And you get COVID, it's just one thing. It's always one thing or the other before people can recuperate and try to get back on their feet. NAREB has, been at the table with the agencies through administrations, having some of the same conversations about housing policy issues that we need. Some of the ones that I mentioned that we are, like the loan level price adjustments, the credit issues, how you calculate credit, the credit models and things of that nature. We have consistently since financial crisis and before just been at the table constantly advocating for ways to overcome, challenges in the lending arena, to increase homeownership for Black Americans. So that is an ongoing, we're at that table all the time. It's just an ongoing, ongoing conversation. It's an ongoing fight. The fight just never ends. So it's for us to stay, keep a pulse on what's going on. That's kind of the beauty. Our members have great relationships with congressional members across the country and policymakers and sit on various boards, because you need to know what's going on in the community to figure out what the needs are, and bringing that back nationally so that we can address that with the administration and with the agencies and with governmental and advocacy folks, policymakers, to constantly be, in communication with them. So my answer to you on that is, that's a big part of what NAREB is and who it is and what we do. And we can never let up, because there's always something.
Yeah, okay. Well, thank you for that. Everyone, Lee gave me a link to a Realtist event that happened in Phoenix. That's what he wanted to show. So I hopefully put it back into the chat so that, or maybe I didn't put it in the chat. Let me put it in the chat. So hopefully you guys can copy it and take a look at it. Let's try that. There we go. So that was an event, so that he wanted to point out. I said, we need more events like that. So I'm not opening it because I'm trying to moderate this, but hopefully everyone can copy that and take a look at it later. Thank you so much for being here. If nobody else has any other questions, I can, let you go back to fighting the fight. I greatly appreciate you taking time, especially during Black History Month, because obviously you're pulled in 1,000 directions. Best of luck next week in San Diego.
Thank you.
And
thank
I hope you have a great event. We all know what it's like to manage these events and being at these events and being pulled in 1,000 directions. And when you're the CEO, you're pulled in 1,000,000 directions. So thank you very much.
Absolutely. So I was happy to come and support and have a conversation with you, Eric. Thank you so much for thinking of me.
Thank you. Have a wonderful day. And everybody else, thank you for joining us. And we'll see you next month when we have some other great topic, I hope. Bye.
Bye-bye.